everybody. The pandemic COVID-19 has constricted us to the confines of our homes. Fortunately, this restraint is merely physical, and we are free to think and express ourselves. Today, I will try to take you through part 4 of the Constitution, the Directive Principles of State Policy. While examining this part of the Constitution, I will take you through the important articles that constitute this part, and also the various judgments rendered by the Honorable Supreme Court on this aspect of the Constitution. While doing so, the interpretive process adopted by the Constitution with regard to the various articles, as well as Part 4 of the Constitution, and the balance that the Honorable Supreme Court has tried to strike, or a harmonious construction between Part 3 and Part 4, as well as the aspect of which part will have ascendancy when there is a conflict between Part 3 and Part 4. Now, there are two reasons why I have chosen to dwell on this part of the Constitution. Firstly, the present pandemic has rendered us, as I've already said, within our homes. This is a mechanism or a policy that has been adopted world over, and India is no exception. Now, while doing so in this country, the state has an added responsibility. The responsibility is to ensure full compliance to the directive principles in providing meals, food, and the basic needs to the have-nots, to the poor section, migrant laborers, and workers. Now, these directive principles of state policy direct or mandate the state to do so even under normal circumstances. And with this emergency that we are facing, it is even more pertinent that the state ensures that it complies and fulfills the obligations cast upon it under this part of the Constitution. Secondly, this part of the Constitution, to me, is the most important part of the Constitution. It is the goal that the constitutional scheme and mechanism seeks to achieve. And with this in the background, let me now first quickly take you through the various articles of Part 4. It starts with Article 36 and ends with Article 51. There are about 18 articles that make up this part. A few of the articles are numbered with alphabets, such as 43A, 43B, 38A, and therefore 18 articles make up this part. Article 36 deals with definition. It gives state the same meaning as in Part 3 of the Constitution, which means that state would include the parliament, the legislature, the local bodies, and all agencies of the state government, of the government. Therefore, the expansive meaning of state in Article 12 applies to this part of the Constitution as well. This has great significance because under Article 37, which is the applicability, an obligation is cast upon the state to fulfill these principles of state policy. Now, Article 37, as I said, is applicability. It has three aspects to it. It makes these principles fundamental to governance, and it casts an obligation and a duty upon the state to follow these principles while making laws. And it is not justiciable, unenforceable in the courts of law. Now, coming to Article 38, 38 is the social order that these principles seek to secure for us through the state. The social order would include justice, social, economic, and political. It seeks to minimize inequalities in income, do away with inequality in status and opportunity. And then we come to Article 39. Now, 39 are six principles that needs to be followed. Article 39, A to F, are the six principles that is provided for under Article 39. It starts with equal rights to adequate means of livelihood. That is 39, small a. Then it comes to 39B, which is distribution of the material community resources to serve the common good. 39C is no concentration of wealth or production to the common detriment. Then we have 39D, which is equal pay for equal work. Then we have E, which is health of workers and to take care of the tender aged children. Then we have F, which is opportunity for children to develop and protection of the youth. And Article 39b, small b and c, have a more exalted status than the remaining part or the remaining articles of this part. This is because of the 25th Amendment to the Constitution. I will come to that aspect of the matter a little later. Then comes Article 40. Before I go to Article 40, go to Article 39A, which is the next article, let me just pause here and reflect to what we have gone through so far. Now, these four articles that we have right now very quickly gone through would clearly indicate that these principles are aimed at achieving an egalitarian and a welfare state, an egalitarian society and a welfare state. Now, let us for a minute have a look at what the preamble said. Now, the preamble starts with "we the people," and who seek to secure for its citizens a particular society, which is a socialist, sovereign, secular, democratic republic. Now, the word socialist has a very important standing, because these directive principles of state policy seeks to achieve that socialist society that the preamble has ensured for seeks to ensure for the people of this nation. Now, Article 40, now let's sorry, 39A. Now, Article 39A is the next article. It deals with free legal aid and equal justice. Article 40 deals with village panchayats. Now, as you know, with a subsequent amendment to the constitution, the panchayats are a part of the constitution itself, and they have a constitutional status. Then we come to Article 41 is a right to work, education, and public assistance. Then we have 42, which is human conditions, ensuring human conditions and maternity. So protection for women comes into play. Then we have 43A, which is again by way of an amendment. It is participation of workers in industries. So straight away, the Industrial Dispute Act comes into mind. Then we have 43B, which is the cooperative societies. Now again, by way of an amendment, cooperative society also is a constitutional body. And then we have 44, which is a very contentious issue right now in the country, the Uniform Civil Code. Then we have 45, which is early childhood care. And 46, again, another important article, which seeks to promote with special care the economic and educational needs of the weaker sections, the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes. Now, all social legislations like the SCST Prohibition of Atrocity Act, or for that matter, Prohibition of Transfer of Certain Lands Act, could all be attributed to this principle. Then we come to the next one, which is the 47, to raise the nutritional level. Then we have 48, which is agriculture and animal husbandry. Then we have 48A, again by way of an amendment, which is forest, to protect forests and environment. Then we have 49, which seeks to protection of monuments. Then we have 50, which is separation of the judiciary from the executive. Then 51, which is to promote, seeks to promote international peace. Now, these articles form the part four of the Constitution. If you really have a holistic reading or a holistic look at this entire part of the Constitution, one thing is very clear, that we must reflect back to the preamble of the Constitution, which, in my opinion, is the war cry of the people of this country, of what they wanted to achieve for themselves through the Constitution. And this goal, these aspirations of the people of this nation, is to be achieved by casting an obligation upon the state, by making it fundamental in governance as well as in lawmaking, to follow the principles. Now, these principles, as I've already said, is a reflection. The aspirations of the people is reflected in the directive principles of state policy, and duty is cast upon the state to fulfill this by following, as I said, the three measures, which is lawmaking, governance, and they are fundamental to governance. So therefore, in order to achieve the socialist republic, where there is justice, social, economic, political, and there is liberty of thought, expression, and belief, faith, and worship. There is equality of status and opportunity, and to promote fraternity, assuring the dignity of the people and the unity and integrity of the country. As reflected in the preamble, it is a bounden duty upon the state to ensure that they follow these principles. That is why when I started off this talk, I did say that to me, this is the most important, the core, the very core of the Constitution, because this is the goal of the Constitution. Everything else must revolve around it, including Part 3 of the Constitution. But I will come to that with the way the Supreme Court has dealt with this aspect of the matter, and how they have tried to construct or come up with various prepositions on how to deal with Part 3 and Part 4 conflict. Now, under Article 45 of the Constitution, as you all know, 5 judges of the Supreme Court have the last say or have the last word on the interpretation of the Constitution. So a 5 judges bench is what we call the constitutional bench, is a minimum. If there can be more, but minimum of 5 benches, 5 judges, constitute the constitutional bench or the interpreters of the Constitution. Now, I will deal with all constitutional bench judgments, which have touched upon the aspects, as I had earlier mentioned. Now, the first of the judgments, of course, there were 2 judgments prior to this, but the first judgment which gave a categorical finding or declaration with regard to directive principle vis-a-vis Part 3, the fundamental rights, is the Champakam Dorairajan case. It is famously known as the Champakam Dorairajan case, which was finally decided by a 7 judges bench of the Honorable Supreme Court. The matter arose from a challenge to the communal GO, or the communal government order, promulgated in the year 1921 by the Justice Party government of the Madras province. Now, the Justice Party came into power on an anti-Brahmin plank. Of course, the Indian National Congress was participating in the non-cooperation movement, did not participate in the elections. And Justice Party came with the majority in the Madras province and formed the government. And true to their ideology, they went ahead and promulgated this communal GO, which provided for reservation for the first time. Now, this, held the field from 1921 till 1952, when Supreme Court decided this issue. Now, when the matter came up before the Madras High Court, the defense taken by the Advocate General then was that this is in conformity or seeks to achieve the objective of Article 46, which is to promote with special care the needs of the weaker section, the economic and educational needs of the weaker section, and the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. Now, that defense was turned down by the Honorable High Court of Madras. The communal GO was squashed. Of course, the Madras High Court said that it is violative of Article 15 and 29(2) of the Constitution. And Article 46, which is the constitutional law, did not even exist when the communal GO was promulgated, and therefore it could not have been taken up as a defense. This is what the High Court had said. As against with the state of Madras went up before the Honorable Supreme Court, Supreme Court took up this matter and said that the communal GO is indeed violative of Article 29(2), and in so far as the directive principles of state policy are concerned, the Supreme Court said it must be subservient to fundamental rights. So when there is a clash between the directive principles of state policy and the fundamental rights, the directive principles of state policy must yield to fundamental rights, and the fundamental rights will prevail. Now, that was the situation and a declaration which was given for the first time before the Supreme Court. And it said that the Supreme Court further said that it must conform, that the directive principles must conform to fundamental rights, and it must act as a subsidiary. Then came the next judgment. This was in 1952. The next judgment was in a reference case, a presidential reference, which was in the year 1957. Now, in 1957, the Kerala government came up with an education bill where they tried to exercise some control through a legislation over private educational institutions. Now, this bill was reserved for presidential assent under Article 200 by the governor, and the president referred it on questions of whether it violates Article 14, Article 19, and Article 30 of the Constitution. Now, in this reference, the Supreme Court again went into this aspect of what would prevail, whether the directive principles would prevail or the fundamental rights would prevail. And it reiterated what the Constitution bench had said in Champakam Durairajan and said that indeed fundamental rights will prevail and the directive principles must run as a subsidiary. But it added what for the first time came up as a theory that at most times an attempt must be made to have a harmonious construction of the directive principles and fundamental rights. But when there is an irreconcilable clash, then fundamental rights will prevail when it is not possible to give effect to both. Now that issue now then came up again before in the famous Golaknath case, where the Honorable Supreme Court said that the Parliament has no amending power to touch upon Part 3 of the Constitution, the fundamental right part. In that, this issue of course was not the main focus, but the Supreme Court did touch upon this issue, and it said it cannot be conceived. This is what the Honorable Supreme Court said, that it cannot be conceived that in following the directive principles, fundamental rights can be ignored. So whenever there is infringement of fundamental rights, even in law is made in furtherance of directive principles, the fundamental rights will prevail. That is what Golaknath said. Golaknath's case, the Supreme Court said, even in the year 1960. Now, next issue, is a very important aspect, is the 24th and the 25th Amendment to the Constitution. Now, under the 25th Amendment to the Constitution, for the first time, of course, 24th dealt with Article 368. There was an amendment to Article 368, as well as Article 13, where Article 13.4 was introduced. Now, in the 25th Amendment, 31C, Article 31C was for the first time brought into the Constitution. It was inserted into the Constitution. Now, this has a great importance and bearing to this discussion that I am having with all of you today. 31C mandated that any law made to achieve the objectives under Article 39B and C, which forms part of Part 4, cannot be called in question on the ground that it violates Article 14, 19, or 31 of the Constitution. Now, 31 dealt with property law, and thereafter it was subsequently repealed. So right now, we are only concerned with Article 14 and 19 as it stands. So any law, so it provided a blanket immunity in so far as laws which were made in furtherance or to achieve the principles under 39B and C of the Constitution, and no challenge could be made before a court of law on the ground that it violates these articles. It also gave a declaration that any legislation which has a declaration that it is made in furtherance of Article 39B and C cannot be called in question before a court of law. Now, these two aspects made Article 31C. Now, this was an issue which came up before the court for consideration in the famous Keshavananda Bharti's case. Now, the Honorable Supreme Court in Keshavananda Bharti's case overruled Golaknath and upheld the 24th Amendment as well as the 25th Amendment to a large extent. Now, the 24th Amendment is, as I said, is the amendment to Article 368 and 13 that was upheld, so that holds the field. Now, insofar as the amendment bringing in 31C is concerned, the Article 31C was upheld. The amendment was upheld by the Honorable Supreme Court in Keshavananda. But insofar as the issue where the amendment said that it cannot be called in question, where there is a declaration that it is in furtherance of Article 39 B and C, cannot be called in question before a court of law, was held to be unconstitutional or affecting the basic structure of the Constitution. And therefore, to that extent, the 25th Amendment was set aside. So Article 31C, after Keshavananda Bharti's judgment, read that any law giving effect to the principles envisaged under Article 39B and C cannot be called in question before a court of law on the ground that it violates 14, 19, and 31. So immunity was granted insofar as these two principles are concerned. Now, let me quickly take you back to what 39B and C, 39B and C principles touch upon. 39B touches upon distribution of the material community resources to subserve the common good. And Article 39C said no concentration of wealth and production to the common detriment. Now, these two principles, so any law made in furtherance of these two principles, were immune from challenge on being violative of Article 14 and 19 and 31 of the Constitution of India. That is what was, that is how the law stood as in 1973 in view of the law judgment laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court of India. In so far as the ascendancy factor is concerned, as to what would have ascendancy, whether Part 3 would have ascendancy or Part 4, or Part 4 would have ascendancy or Part 3 when there is a conflict is concerned, no categorical or decisive declaration was provided by the Honorable Supreme Court. However, almost all of the judges touched upon these aspects and gave their opinion, either individually, in few instances, two judges together gave their opinion. Now, most of the opinion was fashioned to mean that when there is a conflict between the two chapters, every attempt must be made to harmoniously construct them and ensure that the conflict is resolved. But if it is irreconcilable, then fundamental rights would prevail. Certain exceptions to this opinion was made by a couple of opinion. Justice Ray would say that the directive principles can be effective only if it is overcomes the fundamental rights of a few to serve the common good. Justice Dwivedi also on similar lines, said that it is meant, the directive principles are meant to have ascendancy over fundamental rights. Justice Chandrachud would say, and in his opinion, in Keshavananda Bharti's case, that a harmonious construction must be achieved between the two parts. The harmony and the synthesis between the two parts are very, very important. And together, Part 3 and 4 together, is the core and conscience of the Constitution of India. Now, some of the judges also went into the aspect of the directive principles being the goal. But as I said, no concrete or no comprehensive declaration insofar as the issue of ascendancy between the two parts has been rendered in the judgment. Now, then we come to the next most important development, which is the controversial 42nd Amendment that happened in the year 1976 during the period of emergency. Now, 42nd Amendment brought in various changes to the Constitution, and as far as our subject is concerned, it amended 31C once again. What it sought to do while amending 31C was, it said that any law made to achieve the objective of any of the directive principles of state policy is immune from attack as being violative of Article 14, 19, or 31 of the Constitution. Now, if you recollect, that 31C and the 25th Amendment, even after being struck down partly by Keshavananda Bharti judgment, gave the protection or immunity insofar as the laws made to achieve the principles in 39B and C only were concerned. But now this amendment extended this immunity to all laws made to achieve the directive principles of state policy. Now this, and of course, it also brought in two more powers to the amending provision, which is Article 368. It brought in Article 368.4 and 368.5. Of course, that is besides the issue. Now this issue came up before the Constitutional Bench of the Supreme Court in the year 1980 in Minerva Mills case. Of course, by then the Janata government had come into power after emergency. By the subsequent judgment, the 44th Amendment and the 45th Amendment, they did try to undo a lot of the amendments made in the 42nd Amendment. But what they did not manage to achieve because of the numbers in Parliament was perhaps done in Minerva Mills case. Now, insofar as the aspect of 31C is concerned, this issue came up before the Minerva Mills, in the Minerva Mills case before the Honorable Supreme Court. The Constitutional Bench took a view that Article 31C, by virtue of the 42nd Amendment, abrogated fundamental rights guaranteed under Article 14 and 19, and thereby The harmony which has to exist between part 4 and part 3 is destroyed or is disturbed. And therefore, the basic structure of the Constitution has been offended. So the amendment seeks to actually abrogate 14, 19 and 31, and therefore the basic structure of the Constitution is offended and struck down the 42nd Amendment, which brought in this changes to 31C. Now, very interestingly, that it said that the fundamental rights is the means, and the part 4 directive principle is the end. Therefore, in order to achieve the end, the means cannot be destroyed in such a manner, and anything that destroys the balance between part 3 and part 4, which is the case with the 42nd Amendment in so far as Article 31C is concerned, destroys the basic feature of the or basic structure of the Constitution and struck down this amendment. Now, there is a very interesting twist, if I can say so, pursuant to this judgment. I'll come to that a little later. But before that, in one judgment of Bhim Singh Ji's case in 1981, Justice Krishnaya once again gave an opinion. Of course, it had no final bearing on the final issue. It was with regard to a challenge to an Urban Land Sealing Act, where the act was upheld as being as giving effect to 39B and C of the Constitution. But in the process, Justice Krishnaya would say that directive principles are paramount and they must enjoy ascendancy over fundamental rights. But finally, while rendering the judgment, the law was upheld only insofar as it seeks to achieve the objectives of 39B and C, and a direction was also given that the land so acquired must be distributed for the purpose of which it was acquired. So no real law was laid down in that judgment. Now I will come to this twist that I have been telling you about. In Sanjeev Kok case, the constitutional bench dealing with a challenge to one of the enactments went into the issue of Minerva Mills case, because it was time and again Minerva Mills case was presented as the defense to that legislation, and said very interestingly that the question of whether 31C, the question of whether 31C as it stood amended with the 42nd Amendment offends the basic structure of the Constitution or not, was not an issue that arose before the Supreme Court in Minerva Mills case. In fact, no such argument was addressed, and therefore the question, the way in which Minerva Mills case has answered the question is incorrect. But however, they did not go any further on the ground that a review petition of Minerva Mills is pending before the court. However, as all of you know, that review petition has died a natural death, so no, there is no review. But going back to Sanjeev Kok's case, the Supreme Court said that the question of the remaining parts of the directive principles being so drastically different than 39B and C was never addressed. In fact, it cannot be so drastically different, which means that the directive principles of state policy, if taken in a holistic manner, are almost seeking to achieve similar goals and similar in principle as well. So therefore, if 39B and C can be granted immunity, the entire part of directive principles can be granted. And why should not that extension of immunity be granted to the rest of the part is something that Minerva Mills has not considered. And therefore, he says the Supreme Court says that it is not correct. So that is where the confusion stood. But of course, then subsequently in another nine judges bench, in the case of IR Kolihio, the Honorable Supreme Court again had the opportunity to deal with this issue. Of course, that dealt with an aspect which arose from Vaman Rao's case, as all of you know, where with regard to the amendment to the ninth schedule and inclusion of acts into the ninth schedule from the date subsequent to rendering of Keshavananda Bharati's case, whether they are immune or they can be challenged on the ground of being violative of the basic structure was the question, and the power of the Supreme Court to go into the validity of these acts was upheld in Nayar Kolio by the Supreme Court. It did touch upon the part 4 of the Constitution, the directive principles part, and what the Supreme Court said was that one, is a negative obligation, the other part is a positive obligation, which is the fundamental right is a negative obligation on the state, whereas the directive principle is a positive obligation on the state. Both of them must maintain harmony, and individual good must give way to larger public good, and it must be tilted towards the larger public good. But however, if it infringes and completely overrides personal liberty, then it can't be at the cost of such a personal liberty. Fundamental rights will then prevail. This balance, the Supreme Court said, is the essential feature of the Constitution. Therefore, the balance and the harmony between Part 3 and Part 4 is of paramount consideration, although at times public good must override the fundamental rights of individuals. Now, with this, I will come to the conclusion of my talk. Now, this is now how the law stands. If I have to put it in one line, then the balance and harmony between Part 3 and Part 4 must be maintained. If the harmony is disturbed, then the very Constitution will land itself in crisis. Now, if I have to conclude to say, insofar as the ascendancy issue is concerned, and insofar as the Part 4 of the Constitution is concerned, I would say that Part 4 of the Constitution is the most important part, and it seeks to achieve the goal of the Constitution. Insofar as conflict is concerned, if there is a conflict between a law made to serve the objective or to fulfill the principles of 39B and C of the Constitution, then it is immune from challenge of on being violative of Article 14 and 19 of the Constitution. In every other eventuality, there must be harmony between the two, and all efforts must be made to maintain this harmony. In the event of an irreconcilable conflict, where fundamental rights are so overwhelmingly overridden, then fundamental rights must prevail. And in the improbable event of there being a conflict between Article 21 and any of the law made under the directive principles, then Article 21 will prevail. Now, let us not forget that the Honorable Supreme Court has been very, very pragmatic in its approach, and has expounded various parts of the directive principles without perhaps saying so very explicitly in rendering several judgments. Menaka Gandhi's case, where Article 21 where the right to a life of dignity and honor was included in as a right under Article 21. And now, as we see, more than 30 rights have been granted by the Honorable Supreme Court in reading a single line article, which is Article 21. Similarly, with so far as environment is concerned, M.C. Mehta's case comes into mind, and several such judgments upholding Minimum Wages Act, upholding Land Sealing Acts, upholding nationalization of certain natural resources is concerned. All these case laws of the Honorable Supreme Court has expounded the directive principles, and compelled the state to fulfill these principles. Therefore, now all that I can say is, if the state is able to achieve these directive principles, then we can seek to finally get an ideal state, an ideal India, where there is equality in opportunity, equality in status, and there is no disparity or minimum disparity between the poor and the rich, where the women and children are cared for, where the have-nots are provided for, and the downtrodden are lifted and brought into the mainstream. An egalitarian society, a welfare state that all of us dreamt for ourselves when the Constitution came into force. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. I hope this will be of some help to the students of law as well as the young advocates. Thank you.